Is it a fight? Yes, but Jesus told us, fight the good fight of faith. Fight the good fight of faith, because you now have at the right hand of the Father an advocate, an intercessor, a lawyer, a surety, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who will fight for you through every battle if you just give Him, if you give Him your heart.
Is your body falling apart? If you're losing your mother to cancer, you need her to be healed. You know what you need? You need the gift of faith. Extend yourself. Push past the barriers. Believe God with all your heart and push into that area where only God can take you. And when you do that, then the gift of faith will take you the rest of the way and you'll see a miracle. I'm hoping that it will bring enlightenment and open your spiritual mind to be able to see things a little bit different. And the reason why I'm saying these things as I'm talking and starting this out is because we live in a world that really hates God, and it's becoming more and more evident every day. Christianity has become a religion that really is hated and put down and discarded more than ever before. And we can look at it as the world's fault, or as I've said many times before, it's really our fault. And I think that what ends up happening a lot of times is that for Christians, we have faith in God, but we don't have a strong understanding of who we are. Right? We call ourselves Christians, and there are many people who call themselves Christians, but they have absolutely no understanding whatsoever of who God has made them to be. Their perception of life is that someday, hopefully, if everything goes right, I'll end up in heaven with God. And I'm hoping that I can at least stay on track to get there. That, ladies and gentlemen, is an extremely poor perspective of your Christianity. And one of the reasons why I believe that that is the way it's case, that case is the way it is with many people, is because they do not know how to live a righteous life in Christ. Righteousness to them seems like it's a perspective that's unattainable. It's just beyond me. But I know God loves me. So because He loves me, somehow or another, He's going to make me somewhere, weave my way through all of this so that I can finally get to where I want to need to really want to go. Well, that is a poor way to live as a Christian. And when you live your life as a Christian that way, you get beat up a lot. You really do. You go through a lot of stuff. You get beat upon, ridiculed, torn down. Even your mind will become, in some cases, your worst enemy, because you begin to see and listen and adhere and let the bombardment of the things of this world bombard your perception of yourself to the before you know it, you begin to believe what they're saying. And what they're saying is not true. What they're saying is a lie. What this world hands out is not truth. What this world hands out are lies. So we need to understand our righteous principle. And today I want to talk about your new nature. Now, some of the stuff you're going to be hearing today is elementary. But it's almost like God has told me, you need to go back to the roots. Because there's something wrong with this tree, and it's not up on top. The problem with the tree is in the roots. So let's go back to the roots and fix the roots, because if we don't, this tree is going to topple over. It looks pretty, but it's really not pretty, because there's some things going on down deep that need to be fixed. All right? So we're going to talk about your new nature. The nature which is the nature of God. And this nature was given to you on the day that you were saved. All right? Now, what happens is this with philosophers, and we see a lot of philosophers today, and down through our past history of mankind, we see lots of philosophers. Greece was known as a country or as a nation of philosophers. They just sat around and talked and came up with new concepts and perspectives of life, right? Most of it was all total nonsense, but they liked to talk to each other about these new concepts. Paul even refers to it in some of his travels when he finally made it to Athens. And listen, all the gods that they served. A polytheistic mindset. There was a god for this, there was a god for that. So he says, well, I'm going to talk to you today about the god of, that you say there's no name for, that you don't know who he is. I want to reveal to you who this god that you don't know, the unknown god, the real god, that the world today doesn't know. Many people and Christians today are talking about the America that used to be. And why? Because the America that used to be used to have God in it. But 60 years ago, we decided as a nation, we didn't need God no more, so we took God out of the nation. And all I can say to you is, and I say to those same people is, how are we doing with that? How's that working out? Because they told us back in 1962, we were going to be a lot better off by removing God from our society. Are we really that better off? So what we find is that we took the center of our moral structure out of our society, and we expected that we now could do a better job than God could. I think we have proven in 60 years that we are a total failure. That's the way I look at it. Now the point is that now why did that happen? Because God was an annoyance. Why? This is what the philosopher does. He senses inside of him a sense of guilt, shame, inferiority, failure, and even weakness. Now, these are all feelings, emotional feelings within a person that tear him or her down. Don't make them feel good. They make them feel bad. So the philosopher says, I don't really like this feeling. This is a feeling that I'm not really getting much pleasure out of. When you feel down, discouraged, despondent, what do you feel, peppy? Or do you feel like, just leave me alone? Do you want to explode or do you want to hide? These feelings cause us to react to them. So the philosopher says, I don't like this kind of a feeling, so I need to reapproach why I feel this way. I got to stop this feeling. I don't like it. German philosopher Hegel reasoned that he would just simply eliminate God altogether. If I take God out of the equation and just, he no longer exists. All of a sudden, he felt better. Gee, that worked. Everything that God is telling me that's wrong with me, I get rid of God, and all of a sudden, there's nothing wrong with me. This is wonderful. Well, then he decided, well, let's get rid of Satan, too. So we got rid of Satan. There's no more God, and there's no more Satan. Then he reasoned, well, if I take God and Satan out of the equation of my life, there's no reason for me to have sin in there either. Because without Satan, there is no sin. So now I don't have God, I don't have Satan, and I don't have sin. Now there's no reason for me to feel bad about anything that I do from this point on. They're causing me to feel bad. I get rid of them, and now I don't feel bad no more. Hegel took this form of reasoning so as to appease his conscience. There was a voice inside of him. There was a feeling inside of him that made him feel bad about what he said, made him feel bad about what he did. Well, if I can stop feeling bad, I won't worry about those things no more. That's how he got rid of it. No, Christian Science grew out of Hegel's philosophy. And today's moral relativism speaks the same way and from the same kind of thinking. Moral relativism. Well, you say, you Christians say, that what we're doing is wrong. Fine. That's the way you want to believe? Fine. We happen to believe what we're doing is right. So you believe what you want to believe, and we believe what we want to believe. Well, that'd be all fine and dandy if that was the only thing you wanted to look at. But if you begin to go down that pathway, then what ends up happening is morality becomes relative to the person or the given situation. Now, if all of society begins to think this way, what's going to happen to society? It's going to implode. There are things going on in society today that are they're being told to us by those that are in authority that we have no right to speak against. Yet, 20 years ago, it was considered morally wrong. So within 20 years, we are now facing things that were considered morally wrong and are being told to us as morally right. And you have to accept it whether you like it or not. Why? What we find is now that morality is no longer relative. It switched from a Christian moral standard to a relative moral standard to now it's going to be my way and that's it. This is the way Satan does it. If we won't stand up for righteous principles and do right things according to what God's holy scriptures say, Satan will come in and he will exalt unrighteous perspective and he'll put unrighteousness over top of righteousness and force righteousness to submit to unrighteousness. I hope you get that. Because if you understand that, then you can look at what's going on from the eyes of God. All through history, it's not the first time this has happened. All through history, we see societies rise and fall, rise and fall, rise and fall. And every time they fall, it's because unrighteousness has exalted itself above and forced righteousness to submit to it. And that's what's happening. Christian moral principles are being forced in this country to submit to unrighteous behavior, whether we like it or not. We listen to some of the stuff that's coming out on the news, transgender and all this other horse doo-doo. Huh? We got same-sex marriage. We got transgender. Do you think it's going to stop there? What about those who are pedophilia, who like to play with children? Huh? No, Pastor Wendy, that would never happen. Oh, yeah? People said that what's happening now would never happen, and it's happening, and we're having to accept it. It's going to come to a point, I'm telling you right now, it's going to come to a point where those who are into pedophilia are going to say, I can't help it. I was born this way. I have to play with children. And you have no right to force your moral perspective on me. I have a right to live in this world just as much as you. So whether you like it or not, you don't like it, keep your kids away from me. And what will we do as a society? We will submit to that thinking. Why? Because what are we doing about it right now? We're doing absolutely nothing about it. So the more righteousness submits to unrighteous behavior, the more unrighteousness will want. This is how Satan takes over and controls human life. If we don't let stand up for the principles of God, then he will take it away from us. Only the blood of Jesus can set you free from the bondage of sin. Hegel was wrong. You can't just simply pronounce that God does not exist. Because you say he doesn't exist, does that mean he doesn't exist? You say Satan doesn't exist, does that mean he doesn't exist? Satan loves that kind of thinking. If you don't think I exist, I can do whatever I want and you'll never know who did it. He loves people to be ignorant and stupid, to make these kind of ridiculous statements. There are many Christians today that believe we still have the fallen nature in us after salvation. There are many preachers who preach that you still have the old nature that rises up inside of you every so often. This is a fallacy that I want to talk about today, because if we don't address this, it would seem that it does make sense that the old nature does sometimes rise up in us. That old nature. No. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Not one fixed up or with the same old nature. Pastor Wayne, what do you mean by the old nature? Fallen nature. When man was originally created by God, he was created perfect. He was not created by God to have sin in him or have an evil nature in him. God didn't do that. Whatever God does, he always does it correctly. But what happens is, man, even though he was made by God perfectly correct, he was made perfect in the image and likeness of God. Man had a free will, and he was persuaded by the evil one, Satan, to disobey God. And the Bible tells us that when he disobeyed, sin entered into the world. Now, for the Bible to say that, that means sin was not here until Adam sinned, until he disobeyed. When he disobeyed, sin and death entered into this world. So that meant God originally made man to live forever, never die, and to live perfectly righteous, whole, and pure before him. But now we have a sin nature, an old nature, a nature that we had before we were saved. And that old nature, that fallen nature that's within man, God had to do something about that. So what is this old nature? You find it in John chapter 8. Turn to John chapter 8. And the one who discloses it to us is Jesus himself. Jesus explains to us and tells us what our old nature is like and what it does. John chapter 8, verse 41. You do the deeds of your father. Then said they unto him, We be not born of fornication. In other words, attacking their perspective of his birth. We have one father, even God. We have one father, God himself. Jesus said unto them, if God were your father, you would love me. For I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, but he sent me here. He, the Father, sent me here. Why do you not understand my speech? even because, you don't understand me, because you cannot hear my word. He didn't say that they wouldn't hear his word. He said they could not hear his word. They couldn't understand what Jesus was saying because they had a fallen nature. They had a fallen nature. Verse 44, you are of your father, the devil. Now, what he's basically saying here is he's telling them what their genealogical past is. This is where you came from. You came from Satan. You're a child of Satan. Now, if you talk to people that way today, what's going to happen to you? Huh? You are of your father, the devil, and the lusts of your father, you will do it. You will do whatever Satan tells you to do. Why? Because they had a fallen nature. They had a devil nature. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. Now, if there is no truth in their father, would there be any truth in them? So he's telling them, he's speaking to the Pharisees. If you go back and read this whole chapter, he's speaking to the Pharisees and the Jews that were all there. He was telling them what kind of people they were. Now, this could aggravate them, couldn't it? Huh? I mean, if someone started talking that way about you, you know, you wouldn't be even smile on your face. No wonder they wanted to kill him. Because he was implying they didn't have not one good thing about their life. Not one. They had nothing worthwhile. Now, all of us like to have a good self-opinion of ourselves, wouldn't we? But what if someone told you have nothing good? Not one thing good about your life. Nothing. They were very upset. And because I tell you the truth, you believe me not. Fallen nature, people with fallen natures, don't want to hear the truth. The truth becomes an agitation. Much like Hegel, all right? The reason I'm feeling the way I'm feeling is because God's word tells me all this stuff about me, and it makes me feel bad. So my problem is not me, my problem is God. I'll just simply eliminate God, and then I'll feel better. Jesus was telling these men what kind of people they were. Which of you convinceth me of sin? And if I say the truth, why do you not believe me? He that is of God heareth God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because you are not of God. This is straight out, right in their face. They wouldn't hear the truth, what Jesus was saying, because their nature was to agree with the lies of Satan, their father. That was their nature. That was their tendency. Their tendency was to follow after the father that's always been their father. That's the fallen nature. Why did Adam do what he did? Because he heard what Satan had to say, and he did it. Why did he do it? Was he just stupid? No. Remember, he was made by God perfect. If someone's made perfect, are there imperfections in there? That means he knew exactly what he was doing when he disobeyed God. He knew exactly what was going to happen. It was all inside of him, and he disobeyed anyway. Why? Because he was attracted to his father, the devil. And every child born from him, from that point on, would also be attracted to the devil, power of this world, the Antichrist, whatever you want to call him. If we as Christians still have this old nature, that would mean that salvation that Jesus provided through us, through his shed blood, could not and was not strong enough to set us free of Satan's grip on us. You cannot have an old nature still in you. Because if it's still there, then that means that the power of the blood was powerful, but it wasn't powerful enough to separate you from your father. Yet Colossians 1:13 says that Jesus, the power of Jesus, translated us out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son. So you can't claim to be saved and still have the old nature.
Well, we've run out of time once again. However, before we go, we would like to give everyone the opportunity of inviting Jesus Christ to be your personal Lord and Savior. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you are promised eternal life. The Bible tells us this in Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. Let us pray that together right now.
Say, Heavenly Father,
Heavenly Father,
I believe
that
Jesus Christ
is the Savior of the world.
He went to hell in my place.
He rose from the dead
and ascended into heaven.
He is my Savior
and my Lord.
I will serve him
all the days of my life.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
We encourage you now to call and share with us the incredible decision you have made. Our number is 845-677-0625. We would like to send you some information on the wonderful decision you have made. If you would like to visit our church family, we encourage you to come to 3112 Route 82 in the town of Unionville. For directions or further information, please visit us on the web at john316cc.org. Until next week, continue to build your faith with God's holy word.